listening to MCS Live, the best of Lowell sports and beyond on millcitysports.com.
Live Faceoff here live from the Tsongas Center in Lowell, Massachusetts. The UMass Lowell Riverhawks are about to take on the Penn State Nittany Lions. Second night in a row. Last night, the Riverhawks went 5-3 with a winning score and took game one and now own a three-game overall record against the Penn State Nittany Lions. We will be joined tonight, hopefully, by Bob Ellis here pretty soon. And then at some point with Shawn Hutcheon from the Lowell Sun and the Fourth Period Magazine. We'll also be joined by Greg Celona when he comes back from volleyball for UMass Lowell. I'm by myself right now, but we'll be joined soon. We'll be live from the lobby here at the Tsongas Center. The audio will be broadcasted when I'm joined by a partner. So if you're here waiting to get into the game, you'll be able to hear our pregame show and listen in and get some insight on last night's game and tonight's game. What's going around the NCAA tonight? Other hockey action tonight, the Merrimack College Warriors are hosting the Notre Dame Fighting Irish at 7 p.m. That game can be watched on WBIN and on ESPN3 online, as well as Fox Sports SA. Also, New Hampshire will be visiting Northeastern at 7 p.m. also. And then at 7 p.m. as well, Providence College hosts Vermont. And those are all in Hockey East action, non-conference action. Obviously, tonight UMass will host Penn State. And that's the other Hockey East game in action tonight that's not a conference game. So last night was a big win for UMass Lowell. They started their season off with the best start of a season in the history of the Division I. The 7-1-2 record, which beat their 95-96 record to start the season. Last night I talked to Norm. Norm was like, I'm not looking to start, but I guess it's a good thing. And then Bob actually reminded me at the beginning of the game that that's the best start they've ever had. So tonight we'll see if they can continue that record. Robert Francis scored two goals, including the first goal and the game-winning goal, to win last night. So he actually scored the difference. He scored the two goals to beat Penn State 5-3. Sitting out last year an entire season at Western, or after coming from Western Michigan to transfer, he worked hard. Norm Bazin said last night at the post-game conference that he worked really hard, and he came in every morning and still comes every morning, double shifts on his practicing and getting ready for the season. And now he's definitely ready for this season. He's in it. Four goals this season, an assist for 5 points. Definitely a Riverhawk, and he's definitely happy to be here in action. John Edward also scored his first goal last night. Get on the board. He had an assist already this season, but he's on the board in the goal column, making him the 19th Riverhawk to score a goal this season. Outstanding mark. And to believe 21 Riverhawks have points, that's unbelievable. The offense has been spread out, and it's been a great start to the 2014-15 season. So number four, Riverhawk. Penn State's actually unranked. Chris Nisi actually has 10 points in 9 games this season to start the season. That's an outstanding start to a season full of sophomores, as well as Dylan Zink has 10 points in 10 games as a defenseman. Very offensive minded this year, coming in with a flair to shoot the puck and get the puck in the back of the net and set up his fellow teammates in the back of the net this season. He's also a sophomore. So tonight will be a little bit different, but last night we had a great game. A lot of fans showed up. Hopefully fans show up tonight and cheer on the Riverhawks. Hopefully Bob Ellis will be joining us here pretty soon, and then right after that we'll get Shawn Hutcheon in here, as well as Greg Celona to talk some hockey. Hopefully we'll be right back. Great.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East championships. Visit GoRiverhawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey. United in blue.
And I'm back now. Actually, John Bob Ellis just walked in the door, so we'll get him with the headset set up so we can talk some Riverhawk hockey and get the show going. Definitely an interesting game last night. We had 5 goals for the Riverhawks, 3 goals for the State Nittany Lions. And it was a good game, definitely offensive-minded, and a good win for the Riverhawks. I think Bob is ready. Join my
yes,
Bob.
I am.
Bob, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right, yourself.
Great voice to hear. The voice of the Riverhawks.
It's a hockey Saturday night.
Yeah. No, not at all. You can see everybody out as they come in the building and down here in the lobby.
Have you ever broadcast? Palatial surroundings. I have never broadcast.
Really?
Well, believe me, in 31 years of doing this, I don't remember
everything.
Every location. I remember the bad ones.
What did you think about last night's game?
A lot to like and a lot to get a little anxious about. I think probably from Norm Bazin, A, he likes to win. B, he likes he's not teaching
well.
They made some mistakes. I won't say they thought this game was in the bag. I mean, one of the things that jumped out at me was that I thought, unlike some teams that throw in the towel at some point, Penn State battled for 60 for a minute. And I think at times they had a little more battle in them than the Riverhawks.
Mm-hmm.
I think that probably is a little bit of concern, but a good question.
So, I mean, Boyle looked better last night than he probably would have against any other team. Penn State.
I thought he looked good down at Quinnipiac in the 3-3 tie.
But
I think he's gotten better as we go on. He challenges shooters more. I thought he showed better rebound control, but at the same time, Penn State, especially in the first period, but really for the first two periods, put a lot of shots on him. Here, catch it, you want a faceoff. In that case, shooting is as good as a turnover when you're shooting from 55 feet away, no traffic in front, a goaltender, a clear view of it, love it, hold on to it, result, faceoff, 50-50 puck. I will say that, but the Riverhawks have a horrible second period on faceoff. Good first and third. Horrible second. And I'm sure that'll be a point of emphasis.
Correct. But it seems like it's been like that all season. There's been at least one period all season where it's been like...
That's not a good thing.
No. It's like it's this lull period.
Yeah.
And then Norm always talks about how it had come back in the last period. You fell apart. And sometimes it's you can lose a game by just that one period taking it off. Robert Francis last night, 2 goals. You like what he's looked so far this season?
I like the way he's looked. I like the way a lot of guys look. C.J. Smith continued to impress me last night. John Edwards did. And both, along with Francis, for the same reason, kind of their assertiveness with the puck. I've watched Francis for a year plus now. He's a hard worker. He's got good hands. He's got skills. What I saw last night didn't surprise me. What jumped out at me, though, was his assertiveness, his determination with the puck strong on the stick. I liked the shot off the faceoff because he really picked the spot and hit it. First goal, okay, goalie got a piece of it. He's a little guy. I was surprised he got as much on the shot as he did. That said, then the puck seemed to have a mind of its own to work its way in the net. But really, even if you include the Francis, the second goal, all 5 Riverhawk goals come from the high slot. Get the puck in deep, then find someone high in the slot, and for Penn State, that was a vulnerability.
It definitely was, and it just seemed like that first puck, it looked like it was barely, it was like trickle, 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 trickle in the net. It was a pretty impressive goal for Robert Francis. Chris Manicki has 10 points so far in 9 games this season. Did you see this to start this, like when you started the season, like, oh, he's going to have a great season?
No, I mean, he was a guy I talked about to people in the offseason saying we need to see him take a big step, and I think he's doing exactly that. Did I see it specifically here and now? No. I'm not sure anybody does.
No.
That said, I do remember talking to Norm a year ago, August, so before we ever saw Chris Manicia pull a jersey on. And he said that first year, okay, maybe a little bit of, I won't say a struggle, but it's going to be a work in progress. But he thought that because of his hand skills and his skating skills, that over the longer term, this was a guy that could become a significant offensive contributor. So if you told me, at some point, Chris Manicia would have 10 points in the first 10 games of the season. I'd say, yeah, I buy into that, in that I believe in what the coach said in talking about it. Whether it was going to be this year or next year, I wasn't sure. What I do know is I see at practice, on the locker room, in the performance center, a physically stronger, more muscular Chris Manicia. And I think, add the year of experience, add the physical development, and yeah, this is maybe what we should have expected, but we're not sure how that formula works in advance.
good win last night. Best start to the beginning of the season ever in the history of Division One.
Yes. 7-1-2
record. What do you think? It's going to be a similar game tonight? 5-3, 5-2, 4-2?
I think it's going to be a similar game tonight in that I think both teams will just keep doing what they do. Having been at Penn State last year, they were tenacious the second night. Now, for the Riverhawks a year ago, it was their third game in four nights. So I expect Penn State's going to come out and make them Riverhawks work for 60 or 65 minutes. I expect both teams. I don't know that I expect necessarily that it would be a 5-3 game or 8 goals between the two teams. But that's because I've watched UMass Lowell the last couple of years in an awful lot of low scoring games. 2 years ago, I think they won 8 games. So 16 games over 2-plus years that are low scoring, that they win, that they have the poise, that they have the tenacity, they have the confidence to play close games, low scoring games, and not go into some sort of panic or overly defensive shell, but rather just keep doing what they're doing. But I have to learn that this year's Riverhawk team is a lot more offensive, a lot more aggressive in going to the net and getting good shots at the net. If you go back to Norm's first year, he's the head coach, there was a lot of offense, but a lot of it was similar to what we saw from Penn State last night. Throw the puck at the net, throw the puck at the net, throw the puck at the net. I think after the first year, as he added more of his players to the roster, he adjusted. I think he changed the system. I sound like I have insider information because I don't. It's more just observations. But I think he changed the system to talk more about quality shots than volume.
And that's the other thing, is we could see a lot of games this year going, 4-3, 3-2, maybe one goal game, whereas the first couple of years it was 2-1, 1-0.
Yeah.
Now it's more like both teams are scoring more because they don't have the star-studded goaltender that they had in Hellebuck and Carr. They have a good goaltender, but it's not the same goaltender they used to have, but they have that offense to kind of help them along the way. As well as their defensemen. I mean, you lose Christian Fulham, you lose Travis Riedel. You did get Michael Kaplan.
Yeah. As well as other people who graduated who may have been on
correct.
Defense. My name's escaping me at the moment. But yeah, those were defensive forces who also took you from defense to offense, which means one shot, let's get out of the zone.
Correct. And I mean, now you have a defenseman like Dylan Zink with 10 points in the first 10 games as well, who's very offensive minded.
See, now if you asked me, did I see that coming? I would bet more on Manesia than on Zink. Zink in his development last year was becoming a solid defenseman. I didn't see the offensive skills or offensive confidence
correct.
Growing through the year. Mm-hmm. I saw the general confidence growing, but not the confidence to take the puck and make a play.
And he's a great interview. You guys have interviewed
he's
a great
a lot
time.
Of fun.
He's very composed.
Fun.
Go on that subject. How many years have you been doing this now?
This is my 31st
year. You've had how many partners?
Well, the first
one,
I mean, the first couple of years that we did it, a lot of times it was just me. Occasionally there was somebody else working at the radio station. But at some point, Chaz Scoggins became the guy, and we did it for 18 to 20 years together. And this is the second year working with Jim Connolly. They are both unique and thus different, but both a delight to work with. And part of it, working with Chaz, is we had developed a good friendship before we began working. Together. Jim Connolly and I have known each other for a long time. I think there's a friendship there, although not as pronounced as it was with Chaz, who did various other things with, but lived in Lowell and we hung out together quite a bit before we began broadcasting. Jim Connolly, I've known all along. He was a student here. He was student equipment manager, graduating in June of 96. So I knew of him. Knew him during certainly when he went to USCA Joe, he saw each other on a pretty regular basis and so on and so forth. And one thing I had wanted, and I know a lot of teams will often like to have a former player, and there are great advantages.
Correct.
I like having a because I want them to do interviews. I want them to provide. I know people listening to them. That Ellis is on. Yes, I'd like to see UMass Lowell win. I'm happier when they win. I probably yell a bit louder when they score. But at the same time, we try with our broadcast in an accurate picture of what's going on down on the ice. And and thus I want someone that I consider a journalist as the analyst rather than a former UMass Lowell player, although certainly working with Jeff Dahl last year, and he'll be on, I believe, some of them this year. And I say that because I'm gathering it could end up at Ness,
Yeah.
But aside from that, he gives us good analysis, but he also does give it from a UMass Lowell perspective. And sometimes I want it from an observer perspective. It's like what drives me nuts on election night. Here's the Democratic interpretation. Here's the Republican interpretation.
There's nothing.
Here we are in Massachusetts, and this is obviously a rocky election.
Yeah.
Is there nobody in any college that can analyze what we're seeing and explain it rather than putting the Democratic Republican slant on it? Thus, through the broadcast, I'd like it to try to just.
And I sit next to you guys in the press box here at home.
You do.
So I listen. I can hear you guys talk, and I like your guys' interaction. I do listen to you on the radio when you're not here. And I love. I mean, did you feel like you got a home run when you got Jimmy?
Absolutely.
I mean, was it like when Chaz was leaving? You're like, oh no, who's he gonna be?
Now, Chaz had told me more than a year in advance, so I knew, and thus I gave a great deal of thought. And I told Jim about a year in advance. Chaz was beginning his final season. I said, actually, it was when UMass Lowell went to Bridgeport, the NCAA tournament. I grabbed Jimmy and we went out to dinner, and that's the first time we talked about it. Asked him if he would be interested. He had done some broadcasts for Vermont when they were down in the Boston area. Vermont does not have a color commentator in the practice with the radio broadcast. And I gather that they, depending upon where they are, they pull somebody they have some connection to.
Andy Merritt's been doing it a lot lately with them. So, yeah.
But Jim, I knew Jim had some radio experience. And I think that was the year he first began showing up on Nessun as well. Mm-hmm. And I told him I wanted him when he was interested, and he was interested in negotiations.
It's a great thing if you get that journal aspect, but you get a former student, you get them to love the game, and you get that person who got the personality like Jim has. He brings you down to earth sometimes. I can hear that.
Okay.
You're yelling at whatever's going on the ice, and Jimmy's like, well, I don't know, maybe it's the other way. And he could completely agree with you. But he's more along the lines to bring you back to say, hey, okay, Bob.
Oh, yeah, got to be able to
be going a little far. So, but you're still enjoying it.
Oh, I absolutely
love it.
Two sports, and I like all sports. But baseball and hockey, for whatever reason, diametrically opposed sports, both place very close to my heart and bring out all my passions one way or another. And to some extent, what I want to do with our broadcasts, I want to be journalistically accurate. I want to let people know what it feels like in the building. Mm-hmm. And I want to transmit to the listener our passion for the game itself.
Mm-hmm.
We want to talk to people who've been watching hockey for 50 years and think they know everything. We don't want to talk below them. But we, at the same time, don't want to talk over the heads of those who are just discovering the sport. So we try to hit various points in that balance. But I think that's very important to kind of talk about on all levels if possible. And one thing that Jim understands the game very, very well, but has the ability to put it in easily understandable terms, doesn't get caught up in the jargon.
Yeah, I mean, he's great, and I love listening to you guys. Like when you lost the contact lens up at UNH, and you guys are talking about
that.
I'm
trying to be human.
Yeah, and it's great. It just reminded me a little bit of you guys have a touch of everybody's broadcast. TV, radio, everything, a little bit of everything in there, and it's great. And you guys are now on ESPN Radio.
Yes.
You guys, your broadcast net almost a little bit larger than it has been in the past with all the different stations and the app online. You can listen online and stuff like that.
Well, that's something, thank goodness, for people like you and Jim that understand some of that. I still have an idiot box, I call it, which is simply a telephone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have apps or anything. And at times, feel that I kind of lose sight of ways that we can make connections to that audience. That's one thing good about having Jim. One of them, I like to claim founding qualities. But I know that he came in at the second.
But still, one of
the top. But he kind of gets these various ways better than I do.
Well, it helped me a lot because the app itself, 2 years ago, this is the second year you guys are on ESPN Radio.
Correct.
The last year, the Quinnipiac Home and Home Series, the second game of the Home and Home Series is my anniversary. So my wife and I went to away for our anniversary, okay? So I didn't get to go to the...
where'd you go?
Northern New Hampshire somewhere.
It's Did you go out to dinner at that time? Were you in an Amherst checking the app?
No, so we were on the road. We're on the road to New Hampshire. We're driving up, and all of a sudden, I was like, oh, we're out of range. You can't get to the station because it doesn't go everywhere. It's not like satellite radio or anything like that. So I just plugged in my phone, tuned it to the ESPN radio app, and I could listen in the car on the way to our anniversary. And it was great to be able to connect, which wouldn't have been able to 3 years ago, 4 years ago, because you guys would have been not having that technology on the way. You guys had great years in the past doing most of the broadcast, not on ESPN radio. You were on...
For a number of years, we were on WUNL, the University's radio station, which is not a terrific coverage map. For a number of years before that, where I started was with the Lowell radio station, WLLH, which still exists, although I believe it now broadcasts in the Spanish.
Okay. And so it is a student radio. WUML still broadcasts play-by-play.
Yes, they do.
Down the corner of the arena. They're a little bit pushed off, but... they still broadcast. They have a great following as well.
Yes,
you can tune into them. I think
WUML is what? 91.5.
And you guys are on 900 and 1250 and 980 and all these different things. So, well, it was great having you on, Bob.
I got to tell the people, kid. I just looked at my watch, so he said that.
Well, it's because what we talked about only being up
at some point, you know, I do want to go down and talk to Norm and so on.
We talked about with Jim, with Pete. You can come on and join us because we have a little bit of a gap between my co-host, Greg, and Shawn Hutcheon, who's just doing this little fun. And I wanted to get Bob on here.
I figured it out. I know why Pete committed me. I'm filling in for Greg.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
I wanted to have you on. We've had, this is our third time.
I can tell Greg I was a stand-in, kind of a stunt double.
We wanted to have Bob on for a while, and this is the third episode. He always, in the summer when we said we were going to do this stuff, you always said to me, you know, whatever you need, let me know.
Yes.
We'll get in touch. And so I was like, I got to have Bob on. Yeah, I wanted to talk about the Riverhawks, but I also wanted to talk about your broadcast and all stuff like that. And you also do TV broadcasts for the Spinners.
Bull Spinners,
and we're, you know, on Milford Sports, we do Bull Spinners coverage. We had pretty much every game covered this year. It was the first year.
You guys do a terrific job, and I hope you've mentioned on this that you as well supply the ESPN Riverhawk Radio Network hockey broadcast. You'd be a lot of
I try to.
Well, you do. Some weeks it's a little bit more difficult than others, but for various reasons.
Yeah.
But it is part of the pregame.
Yes, and you can do that and listen to that. You guys start your broadcast at 6:30?
Correct.
And you guys aren't on yet, though. Is it all pre-recorded at 7, 6:30? You guys are.
We go on. We're live at 6. In a couple of minutes, I will go talk to Norm. People will hear that before during the pregame. So we'll talk to the opposing skate guy. That'll be on. Now, there are some things that I prepared earlier in the day that air during the pregame show as well. So it's a mix of live and recorded. But when people hear the warm-up interview, the end of warm-ups, we do a live interview from the Riverhawk bench.
And that's new this year, right?
No, we began that a couple of years ago.
Okay.
You know what? We began that in Norman's first year. Maybe a second. I think it was his first year. I had said to him, what do we need to do with these broadcasts that we're not currently doing? He had an idea. I managed to do an interview, live interview with a player if they finished warm-ups. I'm thinking, is this the coach of Riverhawks talking?
And you're telling us now, all of us, and any media people that know who go, you're lying. It's not true.
And I think what it is Norm, I think, presents this to players. Is, look, you're playing at the next level and the next level and the next level. You've got to learn to do this. You've got to be comfortable doing it. This is part of the process.
And Norm loves the university.
Oh,
he loves the university,
oh,
so anything to further the name of the university and things like that, and improve your broadcast, improve the school's outlook and appeal.
But I had never imagined that.
No.
That I had thought
about it. I still think you're
lying. I thought about it. No, I'm not. I had thought about it, and said, I'm not going to push that one. And it was his idea. It was terrific.
So you do that pregame, and then at the end of first intermission, do you have anything planned tonight?
Intermissions, we have interviews that I recorded during the day. Players. And post game, that's all live, star of the game and Norm. And I should say, player, star of the game, if UMass Lowell wins or comes from behind to tie, if they lose, they'll get in the locker room and get ready for more. But Norm happily comes on all of the time.
And is it right after the game? Like, does he go see you before he comes to see us?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, no, players, when they leave the ice, when we're done with the player, Norm steps out of the runway.
Okay, and you guys do it right on the ice on the bench?
Yes.
Okay. That's awesome. You can listen to that at 6:30 tonight. And then you guys would do all the after the game interviews. Who's on playing?
I'm trying to remember. I think A.J. White will be one of them. And Joe Gilbert helped.
White had a huge weekend last week.
That's one reason we spoke with
him. Yeah, he's a great kid. He's coming into his own, too, as ultimate captain this year. He's really...
And also, in the interview, you can just see the maturity. Mm-hmm. He's not the freshman or the sophomore that we remember. He's a very mature leader.
That's one of the things I've actually seen jump on that. Is that at UMass Lowell, you see a lot of that, just in general, even from the freshmen.
Yep.
Some of these other schools that I've talked to and interviewed after games and things like that, you go to speak with them, and it sounds like they're still in 12th grade, 11th grade, 10th grade. UMass Lowell seems like a lot of their – I mean, some of them are a little bit older. People have complained about how late UMass Lowell brings their players.
And Jerry York often mentions that.
About how they bring 21-year-olds, 22 years old.
22, I think what you say, was a 24-year-old freshman from Europe, which was not accurate, but his way of trying to make a point.
Because it's funny, because one of the guys that came over from Russia – was, what, 16 when he came to the school?
Yes, youngest player in the country.
So that's a really funny turn on that. But it just seems like they compose more than a lot of other student-athletes can be at other schools, in other sports, and things like that.
Yes.
I just talked to them in the press game, post-game conference. Some of them are, definitely immature to the aspect of the interview. But some of them are, they're definitely coming to their own. Or made us laugh last night. You made us laugh last night about you.
Really?
Because I asked him the question. So, what are you going to do to keep this going? Because you guys have also the best start in school history, Division I history. And he goes, I don't think about the stats as the first start of the season or anything like that. Although, Bob Ellis did remind me of it before the game yesterday, and then the whole press room, and stuff like that. He was smiling and stuff like that. So when you go talk to him tonight, say, so now you're off to the best start.
Oh, I'm going to mention that because observers have been critical the last couple of years of, quote, slow start.
Yeah.
So I want to know what's different this year.
Well,
can I ask that question? You can listen to the pregame show. I will ask that question. I will probably set it up that way as well.
6:30 tonight on ESPN Radio, ESPN Radio app, ESPN Radio.com, all that stuff. Bob Ellis will be there with Jim Connolly of the USPHO. Awesome to have you on. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for coming in and killing some time.
Pleasure
for Greg not being here, and we'll have to have you on again in a couple of weeks when Harvard comes down.
Look forward to it. You got a deal.
Okay, we'll be right back.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents, Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as the Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East championships. Visit theriverhawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk hockey. United in blue.
So that was Bob Ellis, the voice of the Riverhawks on ESPN Radio. He'll be joined tonight at 6:30, starting at 6:30 for the ESPN Radio broadcast of the UMass Lowell Riverhawks, the number 4 UMass Lowell Riverhawks, as they face the Penn State Nittany Lions here at the Tsongas Center in Lowell, Massachusetts. Tickets are available, so you can line up, get your tickets boxed up, and open right now. Students, you can wait in line outside. The students are already in line waiting to come in. Last night, the Riverhawks won 5-3. Robert Francis had 2 goals, and John Edwards scored his first goal of the season. Kevin Boyle stopped 34 of 37 shots fired by those Penn State Nittany Lions. It was just great to have Bob Ellis on. He has 31 years in the broadcast experience here at UMass Lowell. It makes us look like a complete rookie, as we are. Talk about some Riverhawks hockey. In a little bit, we'll be joined by Shawn Hutcheon of the Lowell Sun and Fourth Period Magazine. He does the Bruins for them, and he does the Riverhawks for Lowell Sun. At some point, hopefully tonight, we'll get Greg Celona here to talk some Riverhawk hockey, potentially some Bruins hockey as well, as we get prepared for UMass Lowell Riverhawks versus the Penn State Nittany Lions here at the Tsongas Center. So, last year, UMass Lowell went to Penn State and beat them twice. This year, they invited them to here, and where the Riverhawks have now one game up on the series. So, tonight, looks like potentially Jeff Smith is at the start of that for the Riverhawks. It looks like they've normally been doing that all season with Kevin Boyle on Friday night and Jeff Smith on Saturday night. We definitely it's definitely great to see the alternating goaltenders. You see a lot of college hockey teams do that to start the season, find out who's hot, and then after Christmas break, holiday break, they figure out who's hot, and they run with the player for the college hockey team. A couple of years ago, you saw that between Doug Carr and Connor Hellebuck, where they went back and forth to see who could stand in the end. Connor Hellebuck won it and ended up becoming a star-studded goal-setter, ranking that goal-setting record, and then eventually going pro with the Winnipeg Jets. And now he's actually with the St. John's Ice-Cap in the AHL. Other games again tonight to recap that are happening. They start at 7 o'clock along with the Riverhawks game. Merrimack welcomes Notre Dame at 7 o'clock. That can be viewed on WBIN and ESPN3. Northeastern hosts New Hampshire at 7 o'clock as well, and Providence hosts Vermont. And UMass Lowell versus Penn State is a non-conference game, and it's the only other Hawkeyes team in action tonight. So, game will drop. Puck will drop at 7 o'clock tonight. Looks like Jeff Smith and Lightfoot will get started at school when they come out for warm-up. Usually we're up in the press box so we can see the people come out for warm-up. Tonight we're live from the lobby at the Tsongas Center. Our audio will be turned on live as people start to come into the Tsongas Center lobby so they can listen on to the show. Right now it's pretty empty, so it would be a little odd to broadcast us live. Overall, the UMass Lowell Riverhawks are 7-1-2 to start the season. To recap, they're the best start they've ever had in division history. The Nittany Lions are 5-2-2, which is an excellent start. I will have to pull a little asterisk, excuse me, on their start. UMass Lowell has definitely faced a little bit tougher competition than the Penn State Nittany Lions. Penn State's faced UConn, Holy Cross twice, Bentley twice, four American Hockey League teams, and then, or Atlantic Hockey League teams, excuse me. And then they've also tied UConn and beat UConn. So, they played started the season off not supposed to be that good, but UConn did come out and they did beat a couple few teams, including Boston College, just right off the slow before the start of the season. But definitely has an uptick on their season in UConn coming the first season hockey. UMass Lowell is ranked fourth in both USCHO polls. Actually, this week, USCHO and the USA Today poll are very common. Top 15 teams are actually the same. I don't remember the last time that actually happened. It's been definitely a great thing to see because it means that both sides of each poll is actually agreeing on who is the better team in college hockey. Although polls don't really matter, as you hear some people say. It does give you a little bit of a barometer on where teams stand in the country. The Riverhawks lead all Hockey East teams in scoring per game, 4.3 goals per game total. They only give up 2.5 goals per game. The Nittany Lions score 3.78 goals per game, and they give up 2.33 goals per game. The power plays are very similar. UMass Lowell is at 25% in the power play, Penn State is 26.3, and the penalty kills 81.8 for the Riverhawks, 77.8. for the Nittany Lions. Again, like I mentioned earlier, leading scorer on the team this year is Chris Venezia. He has 4 goals, 6 assists for 10 points in the first 10 games of the season. Right behind him is CJ, forwards, by the way, CJ Smith with 3 goals and 6 assists for 9 points this season. Dylan Zink and Michael Kappel lead the Riverhawks with 10 points and 9 points, respectively. Jeff Smith has been the better goaltender this season. He has played a few less games. The games he played, he's actually been a better goaltender statistically wise. Jeff Smith has a 1.49 goals against average and a 940 save percentage. For the Nittany Lions, Tyler Holstrom is the leading scorer on the team. He has 13 points this season on 3 goals and 10 assists. Right behind him for the forward is Casey Bailey. It's 6 goals and 4 assists this season for 10 points. Luke Jua has 4 points this season on 4 assists, and Eric Audio has 3 assists for 3 points this season. Last night they started, or actually for all the games this season, Penn State had started their goaltender, Matthew Scoff. Started the season off 5-1-2 with a 1.97 goals against average and 9.32 save percentage. But last night they got pulled in the second period for their freshman backup goaltender, Eamon McAdam, who ended up finishing the rest of the game off. He now holds a 1.92 goals against average and 9.44 save percentage. So it's interesting to see who they start tonight. Likely, I'm guessing McAdam will get the start just after how he, you know, succeeded to play better last night in the second game But we'll have to see when the game starts tonight. You can follow us on millcitysports.com. We'll have a live blog tonight, as well as follow Shawn Hutcheon at Shawn Hutcheon and myself at Jan Soderberg. We'll be live tweeting, live blogging, scoring updates, and penalty updates, and all the different things that are aspects of the game. Again, this is millcitysports.com. We do only have an hour and a half show tonight, so first half an hour has now gone by, and we will be broadcasting this last hour coming up here pretty soon. Soon, right in a couple minutes, we'll be joined by Shawn Hutcheon. He just texted me that he entered the building. He's going to grab a slice of pizza for dinner, and then he'll be down here to talk Riverhawk hockey. You're listening to Mill City Sports, MCS Live on MillCitySports.com.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East Champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championships. Visit GoRiverhawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
I am Justin Soderberg, and we're returning back from that little break we had there. We do only have one commercial this weekend, and the Riverhawks will be getting us some new updated commercials here pretty soon. But just give me a second to drink, take a drink, and breathe for a second. So if you hear that multiple times, then you have to bear with us, please. So Shawn Hutcheon is grabbing like we'll be down here pretty soon. When he joins us, we'll hopefully be broadcasting live to the lobby here at the Tsongas Center at the Penn State Nittany Lions visit the UMass Lowell Riverhawks here in Lowell, Massachusetts. So currently, I mean, last night we had some good news of the Riverhawks winning, some bad news. Christian Follen was actually sent down from the Minnesota Wild to the Iowa Wild of the American Hockey League after only 9 games this season at the professional NHL level. Because of that, he actually played last night for the Iowa Wild. The Iowa Wild actually has a league-lowest 4-10 record for in the American Hockey League, and they have now gotten one of the better defensemen ever to come out of UMass Lowell to join their team. They called up Justin Falk to replace him. But on the brighter side, this update will also be on the ESPN Riverhawk Radio Network tonight, pregame show, our little spot we have with them. Dimitri Nissen, who only played here for a season and a half. We just talked about, we touched on him with Bob Ellis down here with us. He played it for a season and a half, roughly a few games, decided that college hockey wasn't his way to go. He ended up playing in major junior hockey up at the WHL for the Regina Pats. Had a successful season there. Decided that because the Dallas Stars wouldn't sign him right away and put him in the AHL or the NHL, he decided, oh, I'm going to go sign overseas. He had signed a professional contract with the Continental Hockey League, the KHL, in Russia, which is the equivalent, the Russian equivalent of North America's National Hockey League. A lot of players actually come both and play there, play here. Yammer Yager played over there, etc. But they, so he'll be playing, he actually got called up from his VHL team, as they call it, comparable to American Hockey League here. He got called up and is actually playing for Dynamo Moscow in Russia. He has 3 games under his belt, no points. But, I mean, it's for a Russian kid, so growing up in Russia, getting called up and playing for the Continental Hockey League is the equivalent to a kid in the United States or in Canada playing in major junior or junior hockey and getting called and making professional ranks, getting called to the NHL level. So it's really good for him to see him playing in the Continental Hockey League over in Russia. Hopefully he does well. You know, we kind of wish he would have been a star here at UMass Lowell, but because he ended up choosing to go to major junior route and leaving UMass Lowell, he has no eligibility back here. He got a 2-year contract over in Russia. When that's up, maybe he'll sign with the Dallas Stars organization for the back of the United States. But we still consider him a former Riverhawk here at UMass Lowell. You know, you'll see fans who disagree with me, but things like that. If you played here at UMass Lowell, considered a former Riverhawk, in my opinion. You get tracked by our website, MillCitySports.com, and you can check us out. All kinds of professional hockey. You know, it's only over in Italy, but David Valerani has 37 points as of beginning last night, so he could update. Let me check that online right here, actually. David Valerani. Yeah, just check to see if he's got any, if he had scored any more goals. last night or anything like that. Nope. So it's 15 games. He has 37 points, 17 goals, and 20 assists. He has the most points in all of Serie A, which is in Italy. He leads all Riverhawks in points. He has 2.47 points per game. He's just incredible. He, Milano Rosso Blue is where he plays in Italy. They're actually have a partnership with the KHL that eventually, hopefully, the team becomes a Continental Hockey League team and will be playing at that level. So if David Valerani stays with them and so on. David Valerani is actually dual citizenship Canada and Italy. So technically, he's a foreigner, but technically, he's a native Italian player. So it's a little interesting to see that. But he's on pace to score 94 to 104 points this season in 38 to 42 games. He will, if he does that, it will be the most points scored by a player in that league since 99-2000. And if he does that, he will have the most points in the history of Milano's hockey team. And it's just an interesting fact to see, an interesting player to see. You can't see him on TV or follow him online that easily because websites are in Italian and it's hard to just find statistics of people playing overseas. But you can follow him on MilitaryForce.com where we give you up-to-date statistics. We give you the alumni report every month. Overseas. In North America, entering last night, Chad Ruedel had the most points for a North American player, or North American team. Chad Ruedel had 3 goals, I believe, 7 assists for 10 points entering the weekend. Now, I think he scored 2 points last night, a goal and an assist. I'm researching that right now. But he's leading all the team players that are playing in North America. He played for the Buffalo Sabres last year for a few games. He didn't make the opening night roster this year, got sent down. But he'll have a chance, likely at some point this season, to get that call back up to the National Hockey League. He has 2 goals and 9 assists for 11 points in 14 games this season. So he is leading all former Riverhawks playing in North America. A lot of the other players are playing in ECHL or haven't played that many games this season, have injuries, and things like that. So their point values aren't as high as some of the other countries who've played multiple games to start the season. Whereas in North America, the leagues are only about a month old, haven't played that many games. So it's a little bit interesting to see how these things progress throughout the season. You can follow it on MilitaryForce.com, I'm sure. But then you have these players that are playing in Italy, playing in Europe, overseas, and things like that, like 23, 27, 37 points per season so far, and only 15, 14, 2. The leagues aren't going to be. Leagues are definitely different than the leagues here in the United States. They're not as tough, they're not as star players are playing, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, definitely follow us online for our military sports updates on the alumni. You can also listen at between 6:30 and 7. They'll have a pregame show on ESPN Riverhawk Radio Network. And on that, they'll have our alumni updates. Talk about the Shawn Hutcheon is on his way down. He'll be joining us to talk some Riverhawk hockey and talk about what he thinks about last night's game. And what do you think about tonight's game? And the Riverhawks start to the season. They're unbelievable start to the season. And they're unbelievable. Hopefully, going to continue that throughout the coming. It's an interesting thing to see because there's only a few doors that are unlocked in the lobby compared to other the other doors. People keep on coming into the lobby to unlock them for sure.
Can I take one?
So, Shawn Hutcheon hopefully will join us here pretty soon. I'm babbling on by myself for 15 minutes or so, because Bob was hoping that Sean would come down. And it's definitely interesting to hear what he says about the Riverhawks and how they play last night, play tonight. So, tonight, hopefully we'll get the lines here pretty soon, and we'll be able to give you a little taste of who's starting tonight and who's playing tonight. We'll guess who's playing in that because you know how long Maven is and he doesn't actually give us that information too soon in the game. Again, tonight, Merrimack College is hosting Notre Dame. Northeastern is hosting New Hampshire. And Providence is hosting Vermont in Hockey East action. And then UMass Lowell here is actually hosting Penn State University in a non-conference game here at the Tsongas Center in the Lowell, Massachusetts. You're listening to a UMass Lowell pregame show. We have a MCS Live Faceoff on MilitaryForce.com.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East Champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championships. Visit GoRiverHawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
So, long-time season ticket holder and helped among the stats for us, Scott Kaplan. He just waved at me from the other day and looked up at here at the lobby, UMass Lowell, Tsongas Center. And the UMass Lowell versus Penn State University here in Lowell, Massachusetts. UMass Lowell comes to the game of the weekend, so the four ranked in the country in USA Today and USA Show called. The Nittany Lions come in unranked, had similar records coming in. UMass Lowell was 6-1-2 this weekend coming in, where Penn State was 5-1-2. Last night, UMass Lowell defeated the Nittany Lions 5-3. It's definitely the best start in UMass Lowell's history. It's definitely been a great start to the season for the Riverhawks. Hope that they continue to be great for Massachusetts. Robert Francis had two goals last night. He had his 4 points on the or 5 points on the season, 4 goals, and he came up with a great start to the season. Although after having to sit out the entire season last year because of the NCAA transfer rule, he's come into his own, played really well, and definitely come to play here in that role. Norm Bates had nothing but good things to say about him last night. He had props to the guy for coming in early every game, doing double shift workouts to get ready for the season. Last year, knowing he wasn't going to play all season, he still came in, worked double shifts, got ready for the season. He had never seen someone. He's had all kinds of players transfer from school to school, but he's never seen someone work as hard as Robert Francis has to get ready for the season. Even though he knew he wasn't going to play it all last season, he still worked his butt off. Came in, worked out, and four goals, assists, 5 points this season to start the season, and it's unbelievable. See him come and play. He had very little under his belt at Western Michigan. He got he's from San Diego, just like Brad, fellow Riverhawk Chad Rito came from. When Robert Francis was looking to transfer, Chad Rito called him and said, "Dude, you got to come over to UMass Lowell. This is the place to be. This is the place to play." And although Francis arrived after Chad Rito left UMass Lowell, because Chad Rito left after the end of two seasons ago. Not this past season, not this past season, the offseason before that, he left. So he left as Robert Francis joined the Riverhawks. But he said, "You got to come here. The facilities are great. The coaching staff is great. The area is great. The hockey team is great. The conference is great. Everything is great about coming to the school. This is where you need to come. This is where you need to play your hockey." And in the end, it looks like it worked out for him. In the end, it was 5 points in the first 9 games or 10 games of the season. He missed a few games with injury. He's still battling with an injury. Definitely playing his tail off. The other person that's coming to his own this year is Chris Manicia, who has not. Physical, definitely been a better player. And this is a surprising transition from freshman to sophomore. He's my fan, one of my fans' favorites, my favorite player. Dylan's a well spoken kid, well composed kid. He has 10 points in 10 games. His offensive flair has come open. Last year, from the beginning of the game, his defensive team really got into being better, stronger, and more defensive. His defensive is great, but his offensive game has become his own. 10 points. Michael Kaplan's right behind him with 9 points on 3 goals and 6 assists. CJ Smith also has come into his own this year. 3 goals, 6 assists as well for 9 points. It's just been a great offensive season for the Riverhawks this year. Something a little different than Bob and Elf and I were talking about earlier. Something a little different than previous years. The 1-2 game, 1-0 game, 3-2 game. This year is more like Norm's first year, where it's going to be like 6-3 games, 6-4 games, 5-4 games. So close games, but it's going to be the UMass Lowell Riverhawks score more goals, but give up more goals than they have in the past 2 seasons. A little bit different because their defensive team is not good, and their goaltending is not good. Their goaltending is definitely an improvement in what thought it was going to be, but it's definitely not as good as Doug Carr. We're both playing good in hockey now. Doug Carr is in the CHL.
Hunter Hellebuck.
Back-to-back years, the Riverhawks also lost top stars, leading defensemen, and Chad Rito and Christian Bolin to the professional rank. Both of them left before their stuff or before their season at UMass Lowell ended. It's definitely an unbelievable thing that UMass Lowell overcome those losses that they have, and their offense just like soared through because so, Shawn Hutcheon will be joining us here pretty soon. I'm hoping he comes down at some point. He doesn't need to tell anyone to pizza. But you're listening to UMass Lowell pregame show on millcitysports.com. MCS Live. I'm Justin Soderberg. We'll be right back.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East Champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championships. Visit GoRiverhawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk Hockey, united in blue.
You're listening to the UMass Lowell pregame show as they face the Penn State Nittany Lions on MCS Live on millcitysports.com. I'm Justin Soderberg, I'm your host. My co-host Greg Celona is covering volleyball tonight. He will be here soon, hopefully, as well as Shawn Hutcheon from the Lowell Sun in the fourth period of hockey. And last night's game and tonight's game as they face Penn State. Last year, the UMass Lowell Riverhawks swept Penn State in two games. This year, they won last night and are looking to win against the Pirates. They go to the past five. Bobby's starting to slow up a little bit. I think he did like great goal for me. Scoring as well. I'm getting some updates here. So again, I touched on at the beginning of the episode here that Apple has 19 players to score a single goal this season. To be 21 players to score a point this season. Out of those players, some of them are Jeff doesn't have a point, and neither does Kevin Boyle have a point, but they're both goaltenders, so that's obviously a little bit different. But out of those, the only four players to play that haven't scored a goal are Ryan McGrath, who's injured, Gage Huff, Chris Forney, and Tommy Panico. Those four players haven't scored a goal yet. But the only two players to play who haven't scored a point yet are Chris Forney and Tommy Panico. Both those players have only played a few games this season. So we'll have to see. You're listening to the Mill City Sports MCS Live Faceoff on millcitysports.com. When we get back, we'll be joined with Shawn Hutcheon of the Lowell Sun. And also he writes for the Bruins for Fourth Period Magazine. Again, you're listening to Mill City Sports.
Riverhawks are your 2014 Hockey East Champions.
Hey, UMass Lowell hockey fans, season tickets for the 2014-15 campaign are on sale now. Marquee opponents Boston College, Michigan, Michigan State, and Penn State highlight the home schedule as your Riverhawks look to defend their back-to-back Hockey East Championship. Visit GoRiverHawks.com for information on season ticket discounts, benefits, special events, and so much more. Riverhawk hockey. United in blue.
Whatever works.
Welcome back. We're on millcitysports.com. This is MCS Live Faceoff. We're recapping last night's game against Penn State and UMass Lowell, and we're talking tonight's game, Penn State versus UMass Lowell again. Here at the Tsongas Center, we're in the lobby live. People are staring at us because we have our headsets on, and they want us through the speakers. We'll see if we get that far. I don't like my voice. I think Shawn here is joining me right now. Doesn't like his voice that much.
I've never been a fan of my voice.
I don't like your voice. So So,
well, that, you know, we're even then, too, so I'm not a fan of yours either. So.
Both of us have the perfect face for radio.
We do.
I mean, that's the way it works.
Yeah.
But we'll, you know, again, we're welcomed by Shawn Hutcheon of the Lowell Sun in the Fourth Area Magazine. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you very much.
How was the pizza?
Pizza was very good.
Last night we had sandwiches, then we had pizza.
You know, making an upgrade, I think, to the pizza.
Well, I mean, if we had Boston College in town, we'd have, like, chicken, steak,
and,
you know. Yeah, I think some of the guy carving meat, like, at the song, or at the garden.
At TD Garden?
Yeah,
yes.
We have that.
I think it's the same person.
But, we enjoy having free meals for being media and covering. It's a hard gig to have, to cover the media, or to cover, talk to Norm Bates.
It's a tough job.
Last night was definitely tougher to talk to your show.
Yes, the entire, 3-minute press conference with the Penn State coach. But
oh, he was
happy.
He was, wow, this is great. We should do this more like this at home. It was definitely wonderful. So I talked about all start the night. Mm-hmm. He's in great insight of last night's game. Talked about how, you know, it was some ups and some downs. I think most games, never been a game, I don't think, ever where you're going, everything was perfect.
Right.
You know, there's always one thing you can tweak, and especially if you ask Norm. A game could have been as close to perfect as possible, and Norm will still say, well, we could have done better on this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Norm, you won every face off. Well, we still could have done better on this. No, Norm, you won every face-off. They don't win every face off. That's a different story.
No.
What are your takeaways from last night's game?
Well, it was a really strong team effort. Defensively, the team played well. I do think they could have played better defensively in their own zone, especially third period when they gave up 16 shots, I think it was, and 2 goals. And I just felt that they kind of let up a little bit after they took the lead. And in the third period, they kind of let off the gas pedal a little bit. And I just think that it could have been a better defensive effort.
Yeah. Coming into the game, we all knew Penn State grabs the puck. Where the heck they are on the ice, fired at them.
Oh, yeah. They shoot from anywhere.
They kind of helped Kevin Boyle last night. Because in most of the games this season, he would have given up 3 goals on 21 shots. The save percentage was down.
Mm-hmm.
His save percentage went up last night, giving up 3 goals, because they shot 37 shots at him.
Right.
And then, so it's a little interesting to see how that worked.
Yeah.
You know, goals against average doesn't matter. He gave up 3 goals. That was going to go up anyway. So his goals against average went up a little bit, but didn't. His save percentage improved.
Yes.
Because of the 37 shots, it looked like he dropped the puck. Norm and worked close to the team, and it was my first year with covering the team. When Norm's first year here as well, the team was like that the first year.
Okay.
And Bob was talking about it earlier when he was in his team. It was the first year they were here, they were like, they just fired the puck at the net and they went in.
Yep.
It was like whatever shot you could get towards the net, it was the piece of the net. And the games were 5-3, 5-4, and that's the game. The past 2 years. Games have been 2-1, 1-0, 3-2. It seems like most games this year for the Riverhawks are going to be 5 goals scored, 4 goals scored, and they're still going to be close, but they're not going to be the 1-2 games that we've seen or shutout games.
Right.
We've had 2 shutouts this season. It seems they've played a big question.
Yeah, they haven't been the best
UNH,
competition, but yeah.
Northeastern is a little bit of a different aspect on it. When they go to shut out a top-tier team, then I'll say, yeah, goaltending and defensive, great tonight. When you have a team that hasn't been able to score in Northeastern, you don't give up a goal to them. It's not that impressive.
I mean, yeah, that's more of a, you take the workman-like attitude.
Correct.
Blue collar, you just go out there, do the job, 60 minutes, get it done, let's get the win, and go home and enjoy and get ready for the next game.
Did you see the line set?
No, I didn't.
Okay. I'll text Pete and have him bring it down. I'm guessing that Amon McAdam starts to be able to play. The other guy,
probably.
What's his name?
Soskov.
Started the first 8 games of the season, 9 games of the season.
Yeah.
He didn't give up the first, 4 goals last night. They replaced on Methuen's working more goal than he did. He played 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Yes, Methuen had a better first period than they had a third period. But in the same sense, I think, why not give him a shot?
Yeah.
He played so well against UMass Lowell. Well, why not give him a shot?
Yeah, I agree. And plus, Scott, he gave up, in the second period, gave up 2 goals on the first 3 shots that Lowell took at him. So, and if he has played a lot this season. Maybe it's time to give him a bit of a rest and go back up to the McAdam. And as you said, McAdam played very well. He should control the rebounds really well. Didn't give up a lot of rebounds to begin with. And he made some big shots that were very when he had to.
It's fun to see when coaches save or save face for their goaltenders, because Norm did it earlier in the season with Kevin Wells. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Kevin Wells gave up like 6 goals on like 12 shots.
Yeah.
To Michigan. Norm was like, "Oh, the team left him out to dry and all that stuff," and he left all left Smith out to dry too. Like, Smith gave up 2 goals on like 20 shots. So
yeah.
It's like they do try to save, because a lot of it has to do with confidence of the goaltender. If he's only my coach is on my side, I'm okay. That was big last night. We talked to him. I'm fresh on his last night. And I'm trying to play him. Oh, guy, get up.
Mm-hmm.
Came in and was like, "Oh, it's Josh Cummins from the front room." And he said, "You know, what was wrong?
He seemed to, yeah, right. He said
that rough first
period. Off,
yeah.
Struggle.
You know, that would have struggle.
Yeah.
He gave up 4 goals in 12
tries. That's struggling,
in
my opinion.
Yeah. If
yeah.
you're a goaltender, you're going to stop some of those. If your defensive team breaks down, the reason why you're between the fight is to stop the puck if your defensive team gets you. Yes, it'd be perfect to have a defensive team like UMass Lowell had where they stop most of the puck before they got to the net. But in the end, if you get past the defense, it is your goaltending job to start. Yes, there are some times. After early morning against Northeastern, did some bad play, which bounced the puck back and caught. No, foil by surprise.
Yeah.
And that is defensive fault.
Yeah. Yeah.
Stop struggling.
Yeah. He absolutely. I mean, he just seemed to be scrambling and the old expression, fighting the puck. You know, he had. Oh, definitely.
There were so many scoring chances that went wide in the net the first period. It was just like, I mean, obviously where I sit is you sit more center
mm-hmm.
where you sit in the press box. Bryce is more down here.
The goal. Yeah.
So I'm sitting there. I don't think, like, 3 times in the entire period, I looked to my right.
Yeah.
It was, like, right in front of me the entire period. It was, like, it was a pretty. A lot of chances that time. None of them went. So in that sense, yes, chin strike. Soft, technically soft. But in the same sense, you met goal with left and right above with that puck.
Oh, yeah.
Or
especially early in the period, that first period, goals, shots, we're missing the net on a regular basis, really. And for a little while, I was thinking, oh, it might be one of those nights where they make the goaltender look real good.
Yeah.
You know? And but fortunately, for the whole that's a chance.
And that's one of the things as a casual fan. Watching the game, you come by, they go, "I give you a ticket, come to hockey." Oh, hockey, love it. Think that those are all shots.
Mm.
That's different. People are looking for more. I think, like, the first period, the shots were 9-11.
Yes, that's right.
Like, if you're just a casual fan, you're watching the game, they go, "Oh, no, you met a lot of shots."
Yeah.
For sure. Well, it's because of all 10 days ago, shots were on net.
Yeah.
The 11 shots they had pretty much were on net. I mean, I don't have heavy rate in front of me. Yeah, you met a had 11 shots to their 9 shots.
That's
the first period. So look at the shot chart here. Chances. 20-20.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's really what you need to look at.
The 20-20 chances, the even on chances.
Mm-hmm.
But only 9 of UMass Lowell shots were on target. 11 of theirs were on target. So when you look at the shots, a fan, they're like, "Oh, this is either even or UMass Lowell should have more." And in the end, it wasn't because they weren't. And sometimes it's a play. You can see it in the National Hockey League a lot. We fire the puck off the back of the court, and it comes out, and someone gets a rebound. They just weren't doing it. It was going left, right, and then
yeah.
going out to the back of the blue line and stuff like that. So last night was a great win for UMass. Start the season off 7-1-2, and everybody thought they were going to be a crappy team this year.
Yeah.
Except for me. I did say to start the season, they're going to be okay.
Yeah.
They're okay.
Well, I had them the preseason Hockey East poll. I had Lowell finishing fourth. So they're surprising me. You know, but overall, the overall poll, I think, came out that the writers and broadcasters had them finishing seventh or eighth, maybe.
Yeah. So, and I had them, you met Lowell third.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
Providence College, Boston.
I had Providence first.
BU. See, I thought that I believe this kid named Jack Eichhorn, who's going to be out there, has heard of him. He's a pretty good player.
He's okay.
He's pretty good. He's actually from the neck of the woods.
He is. Chelsea. North Chelsea, yeah.
He's a pretty good kid. Mm-hmm. You obviously won't score every game. It's just not.
No.
Not. He could.
Well,
but the
yeah,
chances are not that they didn't score every game. He has 8 points to start the season, or 18 points. Eight points.
That's right. He's second in the nation in scoring.
He has freshman. What I'm worried about is their goaltender.
Yeah.
Is Matt O'Connor gonna be able to hold the whole thing, the whole team together? That's a problem you see. So I think in my now, if I could reset it right now, which is obviously the cheating, you obviously only get 10 games in the belt. But if I could reset it right now, I'd say, see you, UMass Lowell.
Yeah, I agree.
And because of the fact that UMass Lowell doesn't have that Jack Eichel on the team.
No.
This guy, we just said it three times already, 19 players have scored a goal. 19.
I mean, that's unheard of.
I don't think 19 players scored a goal on the entire team last year.
You're probably right.
I mean, there was 170,000 goals scored. 169,000 by Johnny Gaudreau's
line. Johnny Gaudreau's line, yeah. I mean, they were basically, I mean, I know this might be almost heresy to say this, and Boston College fans won't like this. They were a one-line team. They really were. When that line wasn't on the ice, they were a good team, but they were as good as some of the other teams.
And I get yelled at and picked on for it, but I also think people need to stop me. Johnny Gaudreau is a one-of-a-kind talent.
Absolutely.
Same thing with Jack Eichel, one-of-a-kind talent. They're one of those talents that don't come into college hockey. It happened, it was very close. Johnny Gaudreau left last year. There could have been a chance that Gaudreau didn't need the Eichel and Gaudreau play on the same team at the same time.
Yeah.
Imagine that being a
head
game.
Those would have been
so, five. Hayes is good. And the
Arnold?
They're both good players. Hayes is a really good player.
Oh, yeah.
He's not anywhere near Johnny Gaudreau.
Oh, no.
But people put him up there because it was points in the season. I'm like, well, kind of hard to 4 points from your team that has a curve. I just need to get it to a guy and he'll put it in the back of the net.
That's
I get a point. So that's where people. I'm a big fan of this. I
sure.
love that statistic. Point.
Yep.
If you help a guy score or you score, you get the point.
Right.
But I'm also not a big fan of it in that aspect.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
it's like,
I mean,
you had 70 points this season. Oh, you had 66 assists.
Yeah. Yeah. Some players in the NHL made a lot of money.
But I mean, like I said, so I think Hayes is a good player. He's going to be an NHL player at some point, I believe.
Oh, yeah.
It's just not the caliber of Johnny Gaudreau, and that's what people, a lot of people are like, oh, look at Hayes. Okay.
He's okay. Yeah. I mean, really, until last season, people really didn't know who he was.
Correct. You know, in some sense, people didn't know Johnny Gaudreau was, to an extent.
Yeah.
College hockey didn't know who he was.
Oh, yeah.
But the whole greater world knew Johnny Hockey was.
Yeah.
After the fact that he came into his own last year. Boston College will be okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
They won't finish the season right.
No.
Providence College is coming into their own. Gilly's actually looking at goaltender. He looks like outstanding at 10. He actually looks like a goaltender.
Yeah. He's playing with much more confidence. As you know, I know him on a personal level.
Yes.
He was in my son's wedding. But, yeah, he's playing with much more confidence. And when a goaltender is playing with confidence, the team in front of him plays with more confidence, and we're seeing that.
And I think that it's a little earlier in the season to say this. I think Northeastern needs to win tonight.
Oh, I think so.
Against UNH, really crappy team. We have to win tonight. They're winning.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're talking about a team, I look at this, I don't even know what the record is for score, but I'll look it up right now. Northeastern, 0-8-1.
Yeah.
You lose tonight in your first 10 games, you have won.
Yeah.
That's going to be interesting to see because, I mean, I don't even know who's next on their schedule. I'm looking it up right now, but after New Hampshire.
Well,
I guess they play Merrimack. Merrimack's playing pretty good.
They
but
are.
Then they go out and play Minnesota. And then they play Providence.
Yeah.
So you're talking, if you don't win one of the next three games, they're in trouble.
They will be in trouble.
I even picked them fourth in the country, or in the fifth in hockey.
Yeah. Yeah, they were expected to have a real good season.
They could potentially be 8th, 9th, 10th this season.
They could.
And that's as bad as they were playing. They just can't find that.
And then, of course, the question pops, will start to pop up. What about the coach? The watch will be on as to when he'll get the ass.
That's the most stuff. Probably I could speak a whole hour.
Yeah.
The fact that Do I believe Norm Mason turned UMass Lowell program around? Absolutely. Yes. I said to last night, I thought about it for the first time in a long time. Look at them before and after. Look how well they played. Look at the turn of professional players who have come out of the school. Look at the caliber of talent coming into the school. Look at the exposure of the school. Back-to-back hockey, regular season, Frozen Four, all that stuff. All of that, obviously, the players are playing.
Oh, yeah.
Coaches have a lot to do with that. But on the opposite side, how much does Madigan actually have in terms of effect? Why is it fine with Madigan?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Jimmy Madigan over at Northeastern State.
Yeah.
And we've got a great reputation as a coach and a recruiter. And, you're right. Players who are on the ice need to do a job. They're not getting time.
People will fire your cash tag right
now. Oh, I know. That's crazy.
It's insane. That's right. The guys one season off badly, and you fire him and say, see you later?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's I mean, the man's a living legend, and you don't do that.
So it's a little interesting to see. It's great to see how UMass Lowell has mocked the start of the season unbelievably well and played really well. Hopefully they can run. I mean, it is their schedule does get. I mean, you're playing.
That's right.
You think
right.
About the school itself, their dedication to athletics, their money.
Oh, yeah.
All that stuff adding to it, you can get players to come play for you. They're going to put money into the program. I mean, you cannot think of better school like when you think of all across the country.
That's right.
There's no other school I would say, oh, yeah, they should have the quality program. Penn State was great. Awesome addition. I love how they've kept it. They have all that other bad attached to them right now. But, or
different sports.
Correct.
Right?
But I just say, just in
but
general,
yeah,
people
still
associate with it.
Sure.
But they couldn't think of it. So I love the fact that twice last year, twice this year. But then they go to Notre Dame for 2 games.
Yeah.
That would be an ultimate test, I think, on the road against a team that, I mean, you have to swap the pier last year, but it's just going to be a difficult time in their house on the road. See how they bond.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, Notre Dame has gotten off to kind of a shaky start, but, you know, you look at that roster, and that they're just going to improve more and more as the season goes along. I think we'll see some big things from Notre Dame, and they play great hockey together. You know, and you're right. We'll see. That is a real test for UMass Lowell.
Tonight, definitely. Yeah, that's probably the best. I could probably put more money about betting tonight on the fact that Jeff will start. I feel comfortable now that I have all these.
Oh, yeah.
Because of the fact that the past 3 weeks, Kevin Boyle. Even a great night. I think Kevin Boyle shut out North Star in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
Yes. Nice. So it's like, you know, I could probably put money on it.
Yeah.
I think they were all going to fight for survive. They could have come from any other camp walker.
Yeah, I mean, I know.
Boyle will be gone up with me. Play this year or play next year. Lily can play season 1 month. He's eligible for 4 years.
Right.
Play next year.
Right.
It would have been easier.
Oh, yeah. And there are some outstanding junior goaltenders, prep school goaltenders out there. I think there'd be one who could come right in and take the starting job in a couple of years.
So, we just get a lot of hands, but tonight, so Holman's going to get the start tonight, or going to play tonight.
Yeah.
If you don't know, start. Usually, like, random line start, or the fourth
line. That's right, yeah. Well, it seems like the second line listed on the line chart is the line start.
Well, yeah, so me, what's your first line, what's your fourth line? He goes, what?
Yeah,
we don't believe that.
That's right. We don't have a first line, second.
Yeah. So, Holman, Manitia, and Chaffee are on line.
Or quote on
court line one. AJ White, Evan Campbell, Robert Francis. I love that line.
Yeah, they have been outstanding.
Love that line.
Yeah,
Michael Fallon, Michael Collintone, and Jake Camera on the fourth line. Jake Camera, I don't think, played last night, right?
No, he did not.
So, Jake Camera's in there. DJ Smith, Joe Gambardella, and John Redford are playing. on the fourth line. And then Zach Hammers and Tyler Mueller. Chris Horney is in for Tony Pinnett. He's going to go, so we won't see him score a point. So he can't add it to the number of points that are on the team. But Horney, I don't think Horney has a point either. So Horney can hop on that bandwagon. Michael Kaplan and Dylan Smith. That defensive carry is fun.
I mean, to have a defense duo nice and tense in the league and scoring.
Together.
I mean, I don't know if that's ever been done, or it hasn't been done in a long time in any college.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And then the pairings together just play well. You don't have to worry. I mean, Capel's a more defensive than Zink. I think it is surprising to me because Capel was an excellent record this year.
That's right.
He was accelerated because the departure of Christian Cole.
Yeah.
So it's definitely interesting to see Michael Kaplan come in this year. Dylan Zink actually be playing better than him offensively.
Mm-hmm.
I think Michael Kaplan's still the better defensive player. Yeah. I think he's coming into his own. He's definitely coming to a point where he's playing great hockey with those sophomore mishaps that he normally has in college. I mean, these kids are young. I mean, they're not perfect.
Oh, yeah, no. But that's the thing. I mean, to have those two together. I mean, last night, Capel had a goal in Zink and an assist. And to see that production from your blue line, that's something that is icing on the cake, really.
One player that's been missing noticeably, and they haven't hit the stride. He had an injury earlier this season. One person told me he wouldn't be out of the battery. Another person told me he was out today. The consensus is that either in Notre Dame or when they get back, which is harder, that he'll be back on skate, skating with the Dean playing. Definitely more. But that's one of those things you go, which I mean, you put up here. What you do is, I mean, obviously you have to take out Coleman, who hasn't played like his own game. His first game.
I think it's his first game.
So you put him in there, and you know what I mean? Like, so there's not an empty spot for him. But what I would not want, don't screw up the line.
Right, no.
But that A.J. White
and Robert Francis
line.
No,
that's lovely. The C.J. Smith, Joe Gambardella matchup was pretty good.
This was really well
done. John Edwards played really well last round. Really like the team.
He was
read into the line chart, and what we normally say, definitely. Start.
Yeah.
And I was right. New York Islanders prospect, Amon Begadim, who's starting for the 10th season.
You're absolutely right.
And it looks like similar lines from last season. I mean, I don't know if he's gay for that. There's a couple of them, yeah, they're pretty much the same.
They're the same. I think Victor Freeman on their fourth line, I think he's going to use some of them. Right. Same line.
Yeah. Pretty much the same lines. The only thing they did was switch out the goaltender. And over here, Nate Jensen, Mike Williamson.
Yeah, Jensen struggled last night. He was minus four.
So
he's given the night off.
And Mike has played five games this season. So he's not his first game. And so Mike Williamson will be taking the place of Nate Jensen on the second deep pairing. Williamson is a Vancouver Canucks prospect. Better than that, the lines are pretty much the same as last night. So, Sean, you're writing for the Wolf on tonight, right?
Yes, like, correct. That's right.
And you've been doing that now for what, your second year?
My second year covering the UMass Lowell for the Wolf on, yes.
You're still covering the Bruins?
I am.
Yeah. How's that going?
Fourth Period magazine, fourthperiod.com, my fourth season of them.
I think you have to quit it.
No, I just figure this is the year that it all lines up. This will let them win the Stanley Cup.
Oh.
Yes.
In four games.
That's right. Four series, four games each.
4-0.
4-0 will be the winning score. No. Dennis Seidenberg.
Yes, sorry.
He'll have four goals. Yes.
So there you go.
On June 4th, something like
that. Still can't believe that. It's still hard for me to believe that hockey goes that long. Like, it's just a lovely aspect, and I love the fact it's almost like opening day, first day of the playoff, and it's just like, it's like opening day. It's like, yeah, I gotta get one, watch the game, and maybe. definitely not.
Excuse me.
You don't let it happen.
I was just saying, I mean, and just the networks, I mean, had to be just in the glory of New York and LA, biggest market in the country. So, and it was great, great series. So, hopefully, the Bruins are in this year.
And the Bruins drop how far they make it this year. You had them in Anaheim, right?
I did.
So, it's a little interesting to see how they start to see off UMass Lowell, dad, they're not well, Boston Bruins are pretty good, and starting to see them off like they're 10 and 8.
After today, they're 11
7 or 8.
They did Carolina.
Oh, yeah, this is happening.
Yes.
Ryan Hampton didn't score a goal.
No. He didn't. Unfortunately, he was out there for the one goal against it. I saw it.
That was projected.
He had him scoring like 6 goals, so yeah. I remember. Unfortunately. Probably a smart thing.
Well, it's funny. He's Mike McMahon and I'm talking to him. Chatting, not chatting. I don't know. I favor him on Twitter about how. Like a team, you make it sound like you're playing well, or count balance.
Oh.
Like
it's funny how that works.
Yeah, I won. Wait, I deposited $50. I only have $4 in my hand. How did I win anything? Like, I'm not
right.
Winning at all. I lost $46 or whatever.
That's why I stay away from those.
It's funny because it's like I got hooked on it because I did the whole, deposit $25 and get $25 free.
Oh.
I'm like, $25 free. That's pretty sweet. Play a couple games, so just take my initial $25. That was kick. You get the $25 as playing.
Oh, okay.
And you have to play like a lot to get the $25. So, like I've phoned my $25 and I've gotten like $1 of their $25. So it's like, oh, so I had to put in 25 times and I actually call the room to get that free $25.
That's right.
Not worth it. And I can say that because they're not one of our sponsors.
Oh, okay. There
you
we go.
Mean?
I
hear it on
you 100%.
You hear it on 98.5 The Sports Hub and all these other stations who sponsor the DraftKings and Spain and all that stuff.
Right.
And they talk it up like it's the easiest thing in the world because they're getting tons of money from it.
Oh, yeah. So I think DraftKings and the NHL is starting to.
And then the Patriots and the
Yeah.
So it's DraftKings and they're from New England or Boston.
Right, that's right.
That's a cool little thing. It's kind of nice to see Boston County be involved there. Although people who shouldn't be spending money on sports are probably spending or betting. Other games tonight are Merrimack hosting Notre Dame.
Yes.
That's on WBIN on ESPN3. Maybe we'll watch. I'll watch that on the press box.
I don't see why not. People will be fine with that.
Northeastern hosting New Hampshire again. I think tonight is a little bit far-fetched to say must win, but tonight or next weekend is a must win.
Yeah. For Northeastern, I mean, they do need to pick up some points.
And then Providence College hosts Vermont. In a sense, Gilly's it is a must win because Vermont's a pretty good team, and Providence needs to get back on that right track. Still, Gilly's played really well recently. But, we'll see. Actually, it looks like. Here for UMass, both grand teams from the RIT. Played a few games, got re-injured, had more surgery, had to retire. Great kid. Great. Played for the golf team this year.
Oh, that's right.
Great. He was one of the better players on the team. Played pickup basketball. Now he's got a boomer.
Yeah.
He's not hit way from the
I guess not.
Kid, come on.
Poor guy. I mean, he's a great athlete.
Looks like we're going to have pretty good coverage. Team, you write some league stuff, some random stuff, but you also do your post-game stuff following the team.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, usually during the middle of the week, I write the blog piece for the Lowell Sun concerning the Metro River Hawks or hockey and college hockey in general. So people can look for that as well on LowellSun.com. But, as we were saying, it's my second year covering the River Hawks, and it's been great. I mean, you know, they're not only are they a really great team on the ice, off the ice, too, real outstanding.
Bob and I talked about that. We talked about how it's so funny because there's certain players, I'm not going to name names, I'm not going to say anything like that, but there's certain players for other teams who's down still. So really, like, it's like you're good at one thing, it's playing hockey.
Yeah.
And you say count to four, and the kid's like, 4 points in the game? Does that mean I have 3 goals, 3 assists? No, what? It's true. There are players like that. There are also players who are arrogant. True. I have never talked to a UMass hockey player who is nothing. Uneducated, professional, polite, and smart, hockey sense, smart, that is Norm.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to be pretty much similar. If you come in here, like, this is how it's going to be.
Right.
You're going to talk to media like this, you're going to do this, you're going to take your grades, you're going to do this, don't, you're not on my own. And it translates.
It does.
And it shows.
Yeah.
I mean, you can see the transition of players. Even players who are coming here have been here for 2 weeks. Sound good. But
well,
the players have been here for years. Sound better.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I think that all plays into what one likes to call a whole lot. You know, not only do you go out there, it's that lunch pail, blue-collar work ethic for each and every night. But you are off the ice, you act in a very professional manner. And that's exactly what you said. That's how they're trained. And I think they bring that with them to a point where it just gets more and more reinforced over there for 2, 3, 4 years in the year. And they're a great group to deal with.
Nick Gordon's firing the tennis ball at the UMass Lowell spring year. I think he missed the line.
I think he does.
He has. I talked to him, like I said, after he, quote unquote, retired, started playing on. I did a piece on him and said, what's the next thing like that? I love it. He quote unquote retired like a month into the season, and then he did his team and put on a small picture like a mirror match and things like that. But I think the place that he could go, he went. And when he went, he took years to listen to Jason Lambert, the CML coaching staff, he trained everybody because he wants to be a sport.
Yeah.
He wants to be a coach. A trainer, something to do on and wicked smart, wicked knowledgeable, wicked professional, kind person. So it's really nice to see him. And I was really sad. He was picked actually in a poll last year by former player, 2023.
Oh, yeah.
Like, who would have the best season of the coming?
Oh, right.
Far and away, Nick Gordon.
Right.
But.
Yeah. And he hit by kid. Yeah, and that's, I mean, that is a sad thing. No, he does. You're right. I mean, just on his intelligence alone, his personality, he's going to have
a good time. And yeah, I mean, I think he's been to, he's been to like five. So it's like, he's been here, he's played, he's still weird, he doesn't have an office and all that. And I think he's still, so, I'm trying to talk to him. So he misses playing. And I think he's again, he's happy. And you, we couldn't play for. I don't.
I haven't played college hockey in over 30
years. I've
been
playing, and I don't know how to ice. Makes me nuts.
Right.
How do you think it's going to
be? Sure. No, I really think that it'll be another UMass Lowell win. I think it'll be. I don't think it'll be a 3-goal margin like last night. I think it could be a 3-2-4-2 game. But I think the Riverhawks is smaller.
Same here. I think it's another way to score. Penn State his second night last year pushed harder than his first night. I think it's going to be 3-2-3-1. Lower scoring, but a closer game, in my opinion. But in the same sense, UMass will surprise us all. It's nice to be stepping up. I really could be more surprised than stepping up in some more. I mean, it's just the way that they're playing. I want to thank you, Sean, for coming on with us. You did a great lobby show. I think this is one. On Twitter, you can read the stuff on bowlsbar.com, as well as the fourth period magazine. Is it a word for
it? It's no, the word for it.
Thefourthperiod.com, as well as that you can follow on Twitter. It's great. It helps us out in the summertime. Hopefully, we'll come back in a couple games this summer covering Bowl Centers on bowlsbar.com. I'm Justin Soderberg. You can follow me at JM Soderberg on Twitter. Sports.com. Thanks, Sean.
Thank you.
Riverhawk Games. You can listen to the UMass Lowell pregame show on ESPN Riverhawk Radio right now. Sometimes I get wouldn't hear through here. So I've got to figure out how to program on here.
Oh, yeah.
So that when I press play on there, I turn that volume up, press play, so this whole place here.
Yeah.
So if I put this sound in there, you'll hear the 90 seconds.
Yeah, yeah.
And the people over there are like, thank God.
Yeah, right. Good. They finally got a shut up.
That's not at the beginning. I'll probably do some sort of break in the middle.
Yeah.
If there's an interview.
Yeah.
With a player or something, and then we'll do the mentoring.
That's a good idea. Yeah.
Sweet. Thanks, Sean.
Awesome. I got to run upstairs. I like the heat. Doing it big, doing it right.
Oh, yeah. Trying.